I've always wanted to have a go at shooting seabirds, and in particular, puffins. Now, puffins are seabirds, so they live at sea for most of the year, but for a few months during the summer, they come onto land and they find a cliff face to nest. And that is now. They've just come onto the cliffs. So I've come up here to Bempton Cliffs in Yorkshire to have a go at capturing them on camera. Now, it just so happens to be that this month also coincides with the release of Nikon's brand new flagship wildlife camera, the D5. And I've asked Nikon also for one of their 600mm lenses. So hopefully, if I get lucky, I'll be able to get a puffin sort of on the cliff face or in flight and realise my ambition of shooting this fantastic bird.
Well, after a quick walk up and down the coastline, it looks as though I'm a little early for the puffins this year, with only the occasional one on the cliff face. But fortunately, there are lots of other seabirds that are here, and I'm loving the look of the biggest of them all, the gannet.
Well, it's a lovely day today, but it is really, really windy. It's blowing a gale up on top of the cliff right now. But I found a really good spot, just looking down on a little rocky outcrop, which is covered in gannets. And what I want to do is try and get some shots of them in flight. They're quite big birds, but they're really, really fast. They especially, I think in this wind probably doesn't help, but they really whip around. So I'm going to have to really put this camera to work to get the shot that I want. Now, one of the key features of the D5 is that it has 12 frames per second shooting mode, which is shooting speed, which is way, way faster than a regular DSLR. Normally, you're looking at sort of 4 or 5 frames per second. So that's what you get when you pay that kind of money for Nikon's flagship camera, and why this is so well suited to wildlife shooting. So it's 12 frames per second with autofocus and metering, or if you want to turn autofocus off, you can get 14 frames per second. So just so you can hear what that sounds like. Amazing. And it will do that for 200 frames because it's got a really fast memory card in it. So 200 frames in a row in RAW, 14-bit RAW, that's about 17 seconds of continuous shooting. So absolutely perfect for this. Now, so we've got this really nice vantage point, and just above the rock, the birds are in sun, are in direct sunlight there. It's really nice. I'm gonna see if I can get one of them in flight.
The gannets are definitely the easiest bird to shoot because of their size and numbers, but they're still incredibly challenging, even with this top-end kit. Time to seek some expert advice from leading seabird photographer, Steve Race.
Oh, Steve, well, it's a blustery old day today, isn't it, if I'm on the cliff?
certainly is today.
Is that usual around here? Or is
it can be. I mean, yeah. To be honest, it's good conditions for the birds, good conditions for bird photography.
It's a beautiful bit of coast. We've got the sort of the stack there, and they're really sheer cliffs. What makes this so good for birds? For bird watching and for bird photography.
Well, this is the best time of year now. It's early April onwards. April, May and June is the best time. And these seabirds come here to breed, to actually obviously to lay an egg, raise a chick, build a nest. And also what's really important is the food out at sea. So without the food, the birds wouldn't come here. So between the food source and the sheer cliffs, where holes for the puffins to nest in, ledges for the gannets and razorbills and guillemots to nest on, it's just absolutely perfect conditions, perfect habitat for them.
Yeah, and this is actually the only... Am I right in saying it's the only sort of mainland nesting site for seabirds in England?
In England, it is. Yeah. There's other places in Scotland and Wales, but on mainland England, and it's so accessible. Yeah. You can just park the car in a car park, 5 minutes down a path, look over one of the viewing areas, and 250,000 seabirds. Incredible sight.
So, what do you need to shoot birds here? I mean, because we're using the D5 today and,
yep.
and a big 600mm lens, uh-huh. and obviously that's a lot of money's worth.
It certainly is.
15 grand or something. But what, I mean, if you don't have a camera that's, you know, up at the pro level,
yep.
what can you yep. get away with using yep. to get good shots?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, today's a good example. When it's very windy, the birds come really close. So I tend to use anything from 200mm upwards, 200, 300, 400mm. Okay. And then on the cliff ledges again, similar sort of length really. Obviously, if you do have a 500 or 600, you can get closer to them on the ledges.
Yeah.
But with a 500 and 600, especially in windy conditions, it's so hard to track birds in flight. So anything literally from you know, even a 100, 400 is ideal, really. And I find that zooms are better for flight photography because obviously they're changing direction, they're coming in and out. So you need to adapt to it. Otherwise, sometimes with primes, even though I've got a 300mm prime in my bag at the moment, I tend to use a lot. You've got to get them early in the frame before you get the wings cut off or heads cut off. You've got to get them coming into the frame before you can shoot away. So anything literally from 100mm upwards, really.
Right, okay. Now, when you look at, I mean, there are a lot of birds here, aren't there? They're everywhere. They're just like, it's just swarms of birds. Puffins are the most famous one on this bit of coast, but what else is there here?
Yeah. Well, everyone wants to see the puffins, and they are fantastic birds, but for me, here's the gannets. So we've got literally about 25,000 gannets here on the cliffs of Bempton.
Wow, and they're quite big, aren't they?
They're our biggest seabirds, and they've got a six-foot wingspan, 2-metre wingspan, so they're much easier to photograph if they're close. Then we have guillemots, we have razorbills, we have kittiwakes and fulmers. It's just an incredible place to visit and see, and fantastic for photography.
And you run workshops here.
I do,
so
yeah.
You used to work for the RSPB.
I did,
And now you're a full-time photographer.
I am, yes.
And do you do one-day workshops?
The company we've got, Yorkshire Coast Nature, we do photography workshops, we do wildlife safaris around the area. And the workshops we do one-to-one full-day workshops, half-day workshops. Group workshops, normally a maximum of six. It's better to have small groups to really concentrate on, especially for beginners to work through the camera settings and everything. And then we also do boat trips as well under the cliffs. So one of our specialities is the diving gannet boat trip, which is incredible. So we come underneath the cliffs here, go about a quarter of a mile out. We do throw a bit of bait over to get them coming in and diving, but we literally get them diving at 70 miles an hour around the side of the boat, thousands of them coming down. It's a really true wildlife spectacle.
So what are the best months to see birds here? Because they come in really during the summer, don't they?
What a lot of people don't realise is they're all migratory species. So if you come here in mid-November onwards, it's nothing on the cliffs at all, it's empty. So they start to really come in about sort of early to mid-March, and then they've normally gone by sort of mid-late September, most of them. The puffins tend to come in now, early April, and they've more or less gone by mid to late July. But right until the end of October, you've still got thousands of gannets. Any time from March to end of September is fantastic here, yes.
Okay. And then when are the chicks born? Is that?
So what we normally say is May eggs, June chicks. So, you know, some of them are mating now. They're getting back to doing courtship and finding their dedicated nest sites. And then it'll be just a few weeks now. We've already, before they start, literally all sort of laying eggs. But we've got gannets on eggs now. So we've got a few weeks ago we had the first gannet egg here, which is fantastic.
Another great feature of the D5 is its state-of-the-art focusing system. This is pretty much as good as focusing gets. It is really, really fast and accurate. You've got 153 points, 99 of which are cross-type, and it, of course, has got all the usual focusing modes like 3D tracking, and I'm going to try that out in a minute. But perhaps the feature of this focusing system that kind of makes it so much better than a normal DSLR is that it has its own processor. So normally a camera will only have one processor to look after everything, but this has one for imaging and one for focusing on its own. So really, really powerful stuff. And I'm going to try out the 3D tracking now, and I'm going to use continuous focusing. So what's going to happen is I'll lock onto a bird, and then wherever that bird moves, whether it's side to side, up, down, towards me, away from me, the camera will keep it perfectly in focus as long as my finger is half pressed on the shutter button. And that makes shooting such a fast moving subject much, much easier. It's incredible, once you're locked onto the bird, it really does keep it sharp wherever it moves. And you can see the little focus points change through the viewfinder, the little red square. You can see them kind of flick on as the bird moves through the frame. And it's so fast, it's absolutely amazing. One thing that Nikon has fitted to this camera is a brand new mirror drive mechanism. And what that does is it gives a much more stable viewfinder image. And that's really important when you're shooting really fast moving subjects like birds at your fastest burst speed, because otherwise it can be really hard to keep up with them. Well, we've got a pretty gnarly looking weather front coming in, so I think we're going to head inside before we get absolutely soaked. Well, that was an absolutely fantastic day. Really, really enjoyed it. I've not really shot that many seabirds before, so I wasn't sure how much I would like it, but I was really into it. Really, really enjoyed it. And you know, I think especially here at Bempton, where you've got the viewing platforms that sit away from the cliff face so that you can go out and look back on the cliff face, you wouldn't be able to do that without those platforms. And that makes it really, really easy to shoot. And the other thing, of course, is the fact that this thing can do 12 frames per second. So useful, and it can do it for 200 consecutive shots. So it's almost impossible to miss the moment. You pretty much never have to wait for your camera at all. It's always ready to go. So the days of kind of buffers and stuff are just over with this thing. And that's sort of thanks to this XQD memory card, which is kind of like an SD card in looks. It's a little bit thicker, probably very slightly bigger. But it writes at 350 megabytes a second and reads at 400 megabytes a second, so four times faster maybe than a Pro SD card, so pretty quick. So yeah, they're not cheap, but maybe that's the future. Well, that's about it from me. I'm definitely coming back next month when the sort of breeding season's in full flow to try and shoot some more puffins when there's more of them around. So maybe I will see you here then.